in explaining to the Christians in Rome his teaching, or we might call it his theology, on what it means that believers are saved by grace alone through faith and not of works of the law, Paul realizes that this is going to bring up a certain question among his readers. He has said that where the sin abounds, grace abounds even more. And that certainly makes a question arise. And the question is that Paul presupposes, should we continue then in sin so that grace may abound? In other words, since we're now under grace, not law, it doesn't matter what we do. It doesn't matter how we live, right? Isn't it right? Isn't that what you're saying, Paul? Paul's answer to that question is one of my favorite little Greek expressions that Paul uses all the time, megonito, which means by no means. That's not what he's saying. Well, okay then, but how are we to understand this? So we're not under the law, and all of our sins are forgiven because we live under grace. So what does it matter if we sin? It's no big deal, right? We don't have to worry about sinning, do we? We're forgiven. So why does Paul seem to say we should be concerned about sin? If I sin, does that mean I'm not converted? Well, how can I possibly not sin? I'm not perfect. Can I be a Christian if I'm not perfect and I still sin? How do I figure all of this out? This is complicated. I'm not under the law, but I must be obedient. I don't get it. It's so confusing. Well, in Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11, the Apostle Paul lays out his explanation, which answers these questions and shows us the key factor in salvation by grace and also obedience to God. So let's go to Romans chapter 6, and we're going to begin in verse 1 and seek Paul's explanation and answers to the questions that we've asked of what is required of Christians. Now, having a proper understanding of all of this and affects our subjective relationship with God, and it's very, very important for each of us as a Christian. So let's go to Romans chapter 6 then, and we'll begin in verse 1. And Paul here begins with what's called a rhetorical diatribe. In other words, it's kind of a speech gimmick, you might say, where Paul is going to make a statement, then he creates an imaginary person who argues with him. And this is how Paul sets up the argument back and forth with this imaginary person. So let's get into the thought here. Chapter 6, verse 1. What shall we, Christians, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? You see how he sets up that question that he knows will be in people's minds. Shall we go on sinning? What does that expression mean? It means continue. And for Paul, sin is a realm, a state, a kingdom, an age. Shall we go on sinning, continue, remain in the realm and in the state of sin? That's what he means. Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Because that's sure what it sounded like when he said that where sin abounds, grace abounds even more. So he's going to offer a corrective here. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may abound? Greek, megoneto. NIV translates that, by no means. But I'm going to give you the Dr. Rogers Revised Version translation here. Ready? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Hell no! Like that translation? Yeah, Christians should always say no to hell, right? Okay. We, Christians, are those who have died to sin. Christians have died to sin. How do we die to sin? Okay. Give you a little lesson in logic here. A, Christ died to sin. Verses 8 and 10. We died with Christ in union with him. Verses 5 through 7. Christ died to sin. We died with Christ. Therefore, we died to sin. Christ died to sin. We died with Christ. Therefore, we died to sin. So we are those who have died to sin. How can we, Christians, how can we live in it any longer? How do you live in something that you've died to? How can you live in it? How can you have it as a lifestyle? How can you have sin as a way of life any longer? Verse 3. Or don't you know, and I think the Greek is a little stronger, that is, are you so ignorant? Now remember, he's imagining this opponent that he's arguing with here. Or don't you know, are you so ignorant that all of us, Christians, who were baptized into his death, that is, in baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death. What does he mean by that? All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus. You know that preposition into is mighty important right there. Baptized into Christ Jesus. Okay, what is the word baptize? Here's the verb baptizo. What does it mean to baptize? Literally, it means to dip or to immerse or to wash. All right? Metaphorically, the Bible uses New Testament authors as martyrdom. Are you ready to be baptized with the baptism I am? Jesus talking about the cross. Martyrdom, a trial, the baptism of fire, trial. So what baptism means literally as a word has to be understood in the context in which it's used, because it's often used metaphorically. I'm going to suggest that that's kind of the way that Paul is using it here. Don't you know that all of us who are baptized, immersed, washed, plunged into, dipped into Christ Jesus? Plunged into, dipped into, immersed into Christ Jesus? What do you mean by that? We're going to try to find out. We are those who were baptized into Christ Jesus. Don't you know that that means we were baptized into his death? Immersed, plunged into, dipped, washed into his death. We're in Christ, and we're also in his death. What does that mean? Does that mean that when Christ died, we died too? When Christ died to sin, we died to sin, but Christ lived a long time ago. How does that apply to me? We're going to have to think about that one. But that's what Paul is saying. So we were baptized into his death. Verse 4. We were therefore, here's the conclusion, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life. Oh, there's a lot to unpack there. So, baptized into Christ, baptized into his death, immersed into Christ, immersed into his death. We were therefore buried with him. Buried with him. Do you remember being buried with him? The wall says you were buried with him. You were put in that tomb. You don't remember being put in that tomb? Paul says you were put in that tomb. We were therefore buried with him through baptism. And here, obviously, in this context, water baptism seems to be what he's talking about. Through baptism into his death. The word through, dia in Greek. It's an instrumental here. It's a means by which, subjectively, we acted through this in union with Christ. So we were buried with him through the means of. How were we buried with Christ? Through baptism. Into death, Christ's death. So when you were baptized, did you realize you were dying? That you were entering into death? That you were entering into the death of Christ? That that is what you were doing by the act of baptism? That's how Paul would explain it. We are therefore buried with him through baptism into death. Now, let me talk a little bit about baptismal imagery. Because a lot of times when we think of baptism, we just tend to think of water, body of water, getting dunked in a body of water, and that's all that's baptism. That's what baptism is. I will never forget the day I was baptized. I was 17 years old. I counseled with a minister. He said he thought I was ready for baptism. So he told me I was in college, he told me to go back to my dorm and get ready. I didn't know what he meant. So I went back to my dorm and I prayed for a while. And then I showed up at a little swimming pool in one of the college buildings. And he met me there and he had on wading boots up to his hips because he was going to wade with me into the pool but didn't want to get wet. And I stood there dressed in my school clothes, sports jacket, nice shirt, slacks, socks, shoes. And I proceeded to wade into the swimming pool. He looked at me like, didn't I tell you, go get ready? I didn't know. I was kind of numb. I had tears in my eyes. And I knew I was going to die. Because I can't swim. So he took me into the pool. Scary stuff for me, non-swimmer. Dunked me under. And by the grace of God, raised me back up. And I walked all the way across campus back to my dorm, soaking wet with my shoes squeaking all the way. I really felt like I'd died. But thank God I'd been raised. So we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, into Christ's death, in order that, here's the purpose, here's the point behind it, the baptism imagery. I want to talk a little bit about that. So we tend to think about it just as water, but it's death, burial, resurrection. But you know, Paul also talks about baptism as circumcision. So we have to think of the term baptism as more than just getting dunked into water. It's a spiritual thing. It covers a panorama of spiritual principles. One of them is circumcision. As in the old covenant, to be a member of the people of God, you had to be circumcised. When did that happen? When you were 8 days old, if you were a male. Didn't happen to if you were a female. Interesting. But if you were a male, 8 days old, baptized, that's what Paul called circumcision, a type of baptism, because it puts you in the people of God. So what does Paul mean about that use of baptism? Well, you become a member, a citizen of the people of God. Just like circumcision, so is baptism. It's also a washing, a ritual, a cleansing. So it's not just a burial, it's getting washed, getting cleansed. In the Old Testament, ritual cleansings. In the New Testament, spiritual cleansing. Paul also likens it to putting on new clothes. Whoa! Baptism is not just getting dunked in water. It's putting on new clothes. You were had on old clothes, rags, filthy rags, and you took them off and put on new clothes. And that's what baptism pictured. A new life, practically a new person, a new way of living, new clothes. Also, I know, also more, Paul said ancient Israel was baptized in the Red Sea. Now, they didn't even get wet. What kind of baptism is that? I would have liked that kind of baptism. Why didn't get wet? They didn't even get wet. What does he mean by that baptism in the Red Sea of ancient Israel? Well, what did that picture for ancient Israel? Coming out of slavery, coming out of sin, coming out of a wicked ruler who had control over their lives, coming out from being slaves to being free by the baptism of the Red Sea. So all of these concepts. So my point is, when we think of baptism, don't just think of getting dunked in water. Think of the theological significance that Paul has in understanding what baptism spiritually is. So we're baptized into his death, order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life. Or as the Greek says, newness of life. So it's not just about sin. It is, but it's not just about sin. This whole account, some people say, well, this is Paul's theology of baptism. Well, okay, you know what? I don't believe that's Paul's focus. Paul is talking about something more here than baptism per se. He's talking about something profound. He's talking about something where you enter into a new life, a new realm, a new state of being, a new world, a new kingdom, newness of life, old life, dead, gone, buried, new life, alive, living in a new realm, in a new way. Just as Jesus, when Jesus died, his human fleshly body perished. And when he was raised, he had a spiritual body to live for all eternity. Paul is saying, that's going to happen to you too. Your fleshly body is going to die, but your spiritual, you're going to be resurrected with a spiritual body that lasts for eternity. But that's happened to you now. Oh, not the fullness of it, not to find out. But do you realize, Paul is saying, you're not the same person who was baptized. You're a new person, a new life, a new way. Just as Jesus' physical body died, but it was raised spiritually in a spiritual body, you now have that spirituality of Jesus in your life now that will be fully realized one day. And do you see Paul's point? How can you still live like you used to? How can you say, can we continue in sin, when you've just come into a whole new world, a whole new realm, a whole new way of life? You've come out of slavery. That'd be like saying to a slave, well, now that you're out of slavery, what do you want to do? Can I go back to slavery again? Magonito! No. You've been freed. You can't go back to that old way of life. Verse 5. For if, and here it's used as a fact, so it might be better to translate it since we have been united. Do you know what it means to be? In union with. United, in union with him in a death like his. You catch that? United, in union with Jesus when he died. We are now, but were in you. You say, well, that's cosmic. Yeah, that's a good word for it. It's kind of cosmic. We died in him. If we have been united with him in a death like his, then we will certainly also be united in union with him in a resurrection like his. Like his. One day, conferring upon us a spiritual body. But right now, what Paul is getting at is, you ought to be living like you know that's going to happen. You ought to be living spiritually like you're going to be living when you're resurrected. Live that life now. You've already entered into that age. Spiritually, you've already entered into that realm. Live like it. Live like the resurrected Jesus would live and is living. For we have been united with him in a death like his. We will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. Verse 6, for we know that our old self was crucified with him. Our whole being, you might say, who we were in Adam. We're no longer who we were in Adam. We're now who we are in Christ. We've changed heredity. And with that comes a change in the way we live. Our whole person, our whole being, our Adamic self, our life in the old world, our old self was crucified with him. With him. Catch that? With him. We were crucified with him. In participation, in union with Christ. Boy, that's hard for us to capture, isn't it? You, me, all of us as Christians, when Jesus died, we died with him. We died with him. As Adam is used as the collective thing of humanity, the forefather of humanity, so Christ is the forefather, the progenitor, you might say, the representative of all Christians, all who follow him. We're no longer from Adam. We're now from Christ. So our old self was crucified with him so that the body, the soma here, meaning the whole person, the whole being, our whole embodied existence, so that the body ruled by sin, ruled by, enslaved by, the body that was enslaved by sin in that old realm when we used to live in Egypt. You remember when we used to live in Egypt? How we were in slavery and Pharaoh ruled over us? We have come out of Egypt into a promised land and we're going to live a new way. We're not going to live like we did as slaves in Egypt anymore. We're going to live as the people of God now. New way of living. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away. And that is, have the power over us taken away. That old body, that old way of life, no longer has power over us. It's been done away with. It's been taken away. Sin no longer has power over us. Now, that doesn't mean that sin isn't a threat. Sin's always a threat, but it doesn't have power over us. That we should no longer be slaves to sin. Understand that sin is not only doing something wrong. It's not just merely doing something wrong. Sin's not just merely doing something wrong. Sin is a power. Sin is a ruler. Sin is a slave master. Sin is a thing that will exercise its power, control, and dominion over you, except for the grace of God that sets you free from that slavery. And again, Paul's point, when you've been set free, don't you dare go back into slavery. Don't you dare go back to being a slave again. To its power. No longer slaves to sin. Verse 7, because anyone who has died, have you died? I remember I was teaching that in a class one time. I said, you know, if you're preparing a sermon, you want to be aware of theological terms. You want to be aware of what death means, and you want to be aware of what alive means in life. And one of the students raised his hand and said, Professor, I know what death is, and I know what being alive is. I don't get what you're talking about. And I said, well, are you dead or alive? I'm alive. I said, but are you dead in Christ? Yeah, I guess so. Are you dead to your sins? Yeah, I hope so. So you're dead? I guess. Are you alive? I think so. I had him confused by that point. He didn't know if he's alive or dead. But these terms are weighted terms. They mean something spiritually, not just physically. They are theological terms. And that's what we're talking about here. Anyone who has died, how did you die? In union with Christ. That's how you died. You died in union, united to Christ. Anyone who has died with Christ has been set free, justified, acquitted, but like a slave, set free. Set free from sin. No longer a slave. No longer serve sin as a way of life. No longer does sin rule over you. No longer does sin reign in our lives. But it's always a threat. It's always a threat. So what are we talking about here for Paul? He's talking about a way of life. He's not talking about an occasional mistake, which we're sorry for, repent of, confess, just hate it. You know, can you imagine a Christian saying, you know, I really like to sin, so I think I will. Most Christians I know go, oh, nuts, I goofed again. I hate it. I hate it when I do that. I'm so sorry. I wish I didn't do that. That's how a Christian views sin. We hate it. Oh, we get trapped by it occasionally, but we don't live that way. It's not our lifestyle. We don't live in sin. Though we, sadly, occasionally make a mistake and regret it. And know that God forgives us. But we hate it. We hate sin. We do not want to live that way. Verse 8. Now, if, again, since we died with Christ, think about that, church. I want us to think about that. What it means for you and me to have died with Christ. Picture that. We died with Christ. We believe that we shall also live with Him. Live with Him now and forever, dead and alive. Now and forever. Believers plus Christ mutually indwell each other. That's difficult for us, isn't it, a little bit? But then did not Jesus say, for I live in you, you live in me, abide with me, and I will abide with you. I and you and me. What in the world? It's a spiritual union. A spiritual union that we have with Christ, mediated to us by the Holy Spirit. So we live with Him in spiritual union. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, He cannot die again. He's got a spiritual body now. He'll never die again. Death no longer has any mastery over Him. His human physical body, gone. Spiritual body, raised from the dead, never die again. Hey, that's what we're going to be like. Death no longer has mastery over Him. Verse 10, the death He died, He died to sin once for all. But the life He lives, the glorified life He lives, the resurrection life He lives to God. Jesus Christ lives to God, raised from the dead to live to God. We've been raised with Him. How should we live? Live to God. That's how we live. We live to God. Verse 11, in the same way, Paul's conclusion, what should we do? All I've said, what's the conclusion of it? In the same way, count. That's a present imperative in the Greek. This is an order. Count, reckon, take it into account. Reckon yourselves dead to sin. Accept that. Realize it. Live it out. Be dead to sin. Count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God. Live to God. Our lives are dedicated to God. We live for God. How do we do that? Alive to God in, and I would add the words, in union with Christ Jesus. So what do we learn? The Apostle Paul's focus and main point here, I've argued, not baptism, not sin, not the law. What do I say Paul's main point here is? The believer's union with Christ. That's what this is about. The believer's union with Christ. Not baptism, not sin, not other points per se. It is the Christian's union with Christ. And the fact that, hear me, church, that union is the key to both grace and obedience. Grace, yes. Obedience, yes. How do you have grace and obedience? In union with Christ. Paul uses such terms for Christians as in Christ. How many times have you seen that? I've been reading through the Paul's. In Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in the Lord, in Christ Jesus, and in Him. Well, Paul uses it over 200 times. Pretty popular little phrase for him, in Christ. What is Paul referring to in these terms? I'll tell you what he's referring to. He's referring to the Christian's union with Christ. What's a union? What is union? What is the union? The union is the relationship that the triune God has with believers. So it is a relationship. This union is a relationship. The Holy Spirit frees and enables people to become believers and to experience Christ dwelling in them and our dwelling in Christ. And in the Holy Spirit and through Christ to being united with the Father, united with the triune God in a spiritual union. In this spiritual union through the Holy Spirit, the believer is enabled to share and participate in all that Christ is, has done, has accomplished, and who Christ is. Christ mediates to us the things of God. And He lifts up our redeemed humanity to God. Martin Luther called this the wonderful exchange. Some people call it the marvelous exchange. He took our sins and gave us His righteousness. That's a pretty good deal. I'll take your sins and you can have my righteousness. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. What a great exchange that is. Christ gave us what He had. All that He had, He gave us. His righteousness, His goodness, His obedience to the Father. Does that tell us how we ought to live? Since He gave all that to us? And what did He take from us? Our sins. Got rid of our sin nature. Forgave all of our sins. Reconciled us. Gave us righteousness. Right. What a fair exchange. This marvelous exchange. Wonderful exchange. In this union, Christ imparts to us His holiness, His own righteousness, His very life, His sharing in the fellowship of the Trinity. He gave that to us. Thus we share in His resurrected life and in His love, and we are to walk as He walked. Through the spiritual union, we participate and share now in the life of Jesus. You realize that? We walk and talk and share in the life of Jesus. We share in His baptism. When Jesus was baptized, guess what? He you were baptized. That's the real baptism right there. Yours is merely an echo, faintly, of Jesus and his baptism. In receiving the Holy Spirit, Jesus was anointed to ministry by the Holy Spirit after his baptism by John the Baptist. He took the Holy Spirit on our behalf so that we could receive the Holy Spirit in our human flesh. He took it in his human flesh so that we could have it in our human flesh. His ministry, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension to glory, and yes, my friends, his return in glory. We participate in all of those in spiritual union with Jesus. Where Christ has been, is, and will be, we are with him. And he is with us. And in all of this, we are both summoned and empowered to live a new kind of life in a new realm by virtue of our union with and participation with Christ. We no longer live in this present evil world spiritually. We no longer live in this realm, in this kingdom. We, as does Christ, we live in a new realm. We live in a new kingdom, the kingdom of God. Our citizenship is in heaven. We dwell with Christ in the heavenlies, as Paul said, because we are in union with Christ. Therefore, we cannot live as we did when we were in Adam. We cannot live as we did when we were slaves in this present evil world. We have been free to live a new way of life, a way, a lifestyle of loving God and loving others, a way of life that says yes to God and no to sin. Our union with Christ changes the core of our very being because we are joined to Christ's perfect humanity. Now, our union with Christ includes our involvement, our activity, our participation, our response, our trusting obedience, our actions, our directions, our union. The depth of our relationship by the Holy Spirit is reciprocal and interactive. So it's not just a static thing that happened. It's an ongoing, deeply relational thing that we have with the Father through the Son and in the Spirit. It's a personal relationship that's possible for us on the basis of the objective work of Jesus Christ and who Jesus is. So, questions. Time for you to answer some questions. You ready? Here comes the drill. So if someone were to ask you, are you a Christian? How would you answer? Yes. Yes, I made a decision for Christ. Yes, I've been baptized. Yes. Yes, I go to church. Yes, I've been born again. Yes. Let me give you the best answer. I'm not saying those are wrong, but let me give you the best answer. Are you a Christian? Yes, I am united with, I am in union with Christ. Friends, that's what makes you a Christian. All those other things, yeah. But what makes you a Christian is the spiritual union you have with Christ. Okay, how about this one? When were you born again? Oh, I don't know. Let me check my record. Maybe I have it in my wallet. I don't know. When was I born again? Let me think. When did that happen? The best answer? I was born again almost 2,000 years ago. I was born again almost 2,000 years ago. I was saved that day. When I was crucified, when I was buried and entombed, and when I rose from the dead, I was saved. That's why I'm dead to sin and alive in Christ. And I spiritually sit with him right now in heaven at the right hand of the Father and will for all eternity. You know, the beautiful song that we sang asked the question, were you there when they crucified my Lord? It's a beautiful hymn. It's believed to have been composed by one or more African-American slaves during the 1800s. And here's the first refrain. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes causes me to tremble. How should I? Causes me to tremble. Tremble. Were you there when they crucified me? The answer to that question for all of us as Christians is yes. Yes. I too died on that cross. I too was placed in a tomb. I too was pierced in the side. I too rose from the dead and was given eternal life. In Christ, I am both dead and alive. And I'm alive because in union with Him, and because in union with Him, I was there when they crucified my Lord. Amen.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? To tremble, Lord.